Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Helen Hall and I'm the Chief Executive of the Policing Authority. Can I have your attention just please for some safety information just before we commence the meeting at 3 o'clock? First of all, just take note of all the exits. There's one at the back of the hall where you would have come in and two on either side. And in case of evacuation, which I hope we won't need, it's out at the front on the grass. If you do require assistance, just let one of the Policing Authority staff know, and they're located at various points in the room. You'll be able to see them. As you'll be aware, this event will be streamed live on the internet and a video recording will be made of the meeting for online broadcast. So in this context, I'd appreciate if everyone can just now take a little bit of time to switch off your mobile phones or iPads or any other electronics, as that'll affect the live streaming feed. And again, you should just be aware that anyone present could appear as part of the record. In terms of, I suppose, house rules, silence should be observed at all times. And if one of the attendees needs to leave the room, you're asked to do so quietly and without disturbing the meeting. As you know from the information already on our website, today's meeting is an engagement between the authority and the Garda Commissioner, which you are present to observe. Therefore, there'll be no opportunity for anyone else to participate in the meeting. And just, I suppose, another just point of order, just so you know that in an attempt to reduce paper usage, the members of the authority haven't printed the paper, so they will be referring to their tablets or access. They're not playing online, so just so you're aware of that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Helen, for those introductory remarks. Balaira Bacordia, Huini Ushla, August Falcha, Gideon Kaith Crinu, Denudras Polinukta, Le Commissioner Garda Síochána Athair Siúl, Gopaibli. Islas Tharúle Seo, Madhula Cúrsi, Dlí Agus Cúrtin Éirin. Agus Maris Cui, Lás Tharúl, Tomidion Ót Tharúl Freshen, Ót Avi Mar, Can Cahrú Egna Garda Síochána, Gudina Cuegadí, No Mar Sin. Lagu plan Polínachta an Garda Síochána, Fis Séidiog, Fuivrádan Éirachtas I Mianir, Sikatia. Agus tá ránaithe ag an túdarás, cuid a tríd an phlán sin a bhainan le sehwaltacht phobal mar ár glár ibre don crinú seo inniuh. Go garage, be mé ag gléach air commissioner an Garda Síochána, ráitis tosi gear a thuairt, agus in ia sin, déanaí cóháiltaí den túdarás, córá leithi mar gheall ar obair an Garda Síochána a bhainan le sehwaltacht an chóphobal. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the first Policing Authority meeting with the Garda Commissioner in public. Welcome to our public audience of observers and media here in the Royal Hospital, and to viewers everywhere. I am joined by the eight colleagues who with me make up the authority, and by our Chief Executive, Helen Hall, whom you've heard from already. And we welcome Commissioner Noreen O'Sullivan and her colleagues from the Garda Síochána to our meeting. This is a quite historic day of reform in the justice sector in Ireland. And as is appropriate for a historic day, we're in a historic place, a building that used to be, I'm told, the headquarters of the Garda Síochána until the 50s. By contrast with this beautiful old building, the Policing Authority is a very new agency, not quite 4 months old, which was established to oversee the performance of the Garda Síochána of its functions in relation to policing services. While our work is in its infancy, we have already had a number of plenary and committee meetings with Commissioner O'Sullivan and members of her senior team, as we work together towards a mutual objective of continuous improvement in policing. There are few public services more important than effective policing for the well-being of society, for community confidence, and for the security of the state. Public confidence in policing and in the oversight of policing is at the heart of the far-reaching reform to which the Minister for Justice and Equality referred when she was proposing the Policing Authority Bill. Enhanced transparency is a central tenet of the reform, which is why we're here today in public. We have an audience here as observers, symbols, if you like, of that enhanced transparency. And the meeting, as Helen has advised you, is being broadcast and webcast as we speak. Performance is a very broad concept. It's important that the authority's oversight of policing performance is focused and strategic in a way that recognises the distinct and different roles of the authority and of the Garda Commissioner. One way of assessing performance is to look at what an organisation said they would do and examine whether they did that, what worked, what didn't, and to look at costs and risks. Our statutory framework foresees a cycle where the authority sets policing priorities with the approval of the minister. The commissioner prepares a policing plan for our approval, and the authority oversees and assesses performance against that plan. The policing plan for 2016 was laid before the IRC this last January, and we consider it to be a good starting point for our public conversation with the Garda Commissioner. We chose part three of the plan relating to community safety as our agenda for today. I would like to underline the word I used, the word conversation. This is not an investigation, this is not an interrogation. We don't expect the Garda team to have every fact and figure at their fingertips. It's also important to say that oversight and accountability ought not to be seen as focusing principally on fault finding. We want to hear about the work, seen and unseen, that the Garda Síochána and the staff of the Garda Síochána do every day to keep our communities safe. I will now invite Commissioner O'Sullivan to make a short opening statement. We have decided as a way of working that four authority members will lead the discussion on this occasion and the other four the next time. There are, as it happens, four objectives in part three of the policing plan for 2016, and we will refer to those objectives as we go along. I expect the conversation that follows will take about an hour and a half, but we'll finish at 5 o'clock in any event, and I will move the discussion along, if necessary, to make sure that the material in the plan gets covered. So, Commissioner, if I could invite you, please, to make your opening remarks.
Thank you. Chairperson, members of the Policing Authority, ladies and gentlemen, this is, as the Chair said, a very important meeting. In and of itself, it's important. As a landmark in the history of An Garda Síochána, it's hugely significant. A professional policing service with robust governance practices and structures is pivotal to our democracy. As you will be aware, An Garda Síochána is unique amongst policing services as a unitary body responsible for the security of the state and the provision of policing services. Two very different functions. Two functions united by an underpinning philosophy, the protection of the individual and the safety of the community, delivered in a framework of community policing ethos. Every member of An Garda Síochána, Garda, civilian and reserve, serves the community every single day. We pride ourselves on being of the community and working for the community, so the safety of the community is central to everything we do, as is trust. Trust is crucial. And the fantastic thing about it is that it's a two-way process. Every time a member of An Garda Síochána proves to a member of the community that they can trust them, they learn to trust the whole service. They trust An Garda Síochána. But An Garda Síochána and every single one of our members must every single day earn that trust. District and divisional officers work very closely with joint policing committees and local policing fora, where they're held accountable for the policing of their communities. Trust is developed and nurtured at all levels within the organisation. Every single day, the men and women of An Garda Síochána serve the community the length and breadth of the country to earn and continue to maintain that trust. From the beginning of my term as Commissioner, we have forged a new direction when it comes to our critical friends. Individuals and organisations that take a view on how we do what we do. We have listened to the findings of all of those reports, tribunals, commissions and coverage over the last 10 years. As the Chair has said, when the Minister committed to the reform of An Garda Síochána, we took that commitment very, very seriously. We decided that we were going to demonstrate and show how we were going to do it. So what we did, we took the 41 reports that have been commissioned into An Garda Síochána since 2005 and when the 2005 Act came in. Those 41 reports, including 10 reports of the Garda Inspectorate, contain 784 recommendations. 485 of those recommendations are contained in the 10 reports of the Garda Inspectorate. We have used those reports to frame what is now our modernisation and renewal programme. The members of the policing authority will have seen from the outset that this is not where we're at. We're not trying to be defensive, and we want to engage and listen to all of our critical friends. Not now. We're committed to openness, transparency, and accountability, to listening, to learning, because it is all about trust and how that trust is built and maintained. We're already getting there. Current research of trust into An Garda Síochána has been consistently high over the last four quarters. It indicates a positive trend, but one that we cannot take for granted. The trend indicates that there is 85% of the public expressing their trust in An Garda Síochána and its performance. We cannot do our job without the support of the community, so that trust and confidence is very, very important to us. But we see it very much as a baseline figure on which to build, and it's not easy to build on it. Crime and criminality continue to evolve and present different challenges to us. We have to move quickly and flexibly to cope with it. We've made major changes this year alone in response to drugs and organised crime, and we are constantly developing strategies to address other emerging crime challenges. The Police Authority is separate and independent from An Garda Síochána, but the two organisations are driven by parallel objectives, by a shared sense of purpose, to make sure An Garda Síochána becomes a beacon of policing that can be measured against any police service in the world. We very much look forward to working with the authority and the identification of their priorities. If you look at any of the news websites on any weekend, the one thing that you can be sure of is that An Garda Síochána will figure. Whether we're seeking information about an incident, dealing with a traffic tragedy, or warning people about a particular threat in a particular area. But we must never miss the opportunity to highlight the more positive aspects of our work. We're part of the community, and when I talk about our function in keeping the community safe, sometimes that happens as part of a celebration. And most recently that was seen in the St. Patrick's Day celebrations, and even more significantly, the 1916 Easter Rising commemorations were hugely successful and passed off without incident. The central ethos for these policing operations was community safety, and the men and women of An Garda Síochána who policed these events showed fantastic, understated professionalism. Working with colleagues from right across state agencies and different government departments, the professionalism, the dedication and the commitment to service was palpable for all to see. I look forward to my team to answering the questions posed here today, and as I say, believe we have a shared objective of promoting trust and confidence in the provision of policing service. I welcome the insight and perspective of each of the authority members into policing and our activity over the past few months. And now, Chair, I'd like to introduce the team. So maybe from my left, we have Mr. Gurchan Singh, who's the head of our Garda Síochána Analysis Service. Next to him is Assistant Commissioner Jack Nolan, who has managing some responsibilities at the moment, but including the Dublin Metropolitan Region. Next to me on my left is Deputy Commissioner John Toomey, who's in charge of operations. On my right, Deputy Commissioner Donal O'Coolan, who's in charge of governance and strategy. On his right, Assistant Commissioner John O'Mahony, who again is managing a number of portfolios, but today is here wearing his traffic, in charge of traffic. And on his right again, we have Chief Superintendent Aidan Reid, who's in charge of our traffic department. And then on the back wall, the rest of the team are represented by Superintendent Jerry Murphy from our press office, Superintendent John Keegan from our governance section, Superintendent Marie Broderick from Corporate Services, and our Head of Legal Affairs, Ken Ruan.
Thank you very much, Commissioner. I will introduce the various members of the authority according as they take the floor to lead the questioning. The first two objectives under community safety that are in your plan for 2016, the first one is to collaborate more closely with communities to address crime, public safety, and the fear of crime. And the second one, to provide greater Garda visibility and create better opportunities to proactively prevent crime and offending in our communities. The conversation on those two objectives together is going to be led by authority members Judith Gillespie and Bob Collins. And we'll take as much time as we need, but we do need to move the material along. So if I could encourage both my team and your team to be succinct in their answers, we'll get more ground covered. So maybe Judith, you'd like to lead off.
Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon, Commissioner, and to your team. Could I start by congratulating you all on the recent safe and successful policing of major events here, and also in relation to successes against crime gangs in Operation Thor, reductions in burglary, drugs seized, and firearms and munitions seized across the Irish Republic. Undoubtedly, your work has saved lives, and I want to very much welcome that. But in that context, recent events undoubtedly have served to increase fear of crime in some communities, and some communities feel very vulnerable, maybe more so than others. So I'd like to hear from you about the new community policing framework, how you think that will help to reduce fear of crime, how you will make it real across the whole organisation, and how you will measure success.
Yes, thank you. It's indeed a very important question, because community engagement and public safety goes to the heart of exactly what we do every single day. And I'd like to thank you very much for the comments in relation to the successes. And obviously, you know, it's a matter of public record, the recent murders that have taken place, and obviously the impact that that has on communities is very great. But I think the one certain thing that we can say is that the perpetrators of those crimes do not have the support of the communities where these crimes happened, and quite the opposite. We're very, very conscious in our engagement with the communities, not only where these crimes happen, but right throughout the country, that the need for reassurance is always, it has never been greater. And that's why, as I said in my opening remarks, our community policing is our ethos. It's not just something that we do in isolation, it's actually what every single member of An Garda Síochána does every single day. In terms of our community policing framework, you will have seen from our modernisation and renewal programme a very thought out structure to how we're going to achieve that, and actually making our community policing ethos very, very meaningful with community policing teams. So I might ask my colleague Deputy Commissioner Toomey and Assistant Commissioner Nolan to speak to exactly what our plans are in place for that.
Thank you, Commissioner. Just following on and from the opening remarks, we very much see that community policing is not a specialist function. It is the ethos of the organisation. And we've set out in a modernisation and renewal programme a plan as to how we're going to deliver and achieve that objective. We very much see that we're providing a service to local communities throughout of this, and the structure that we have proposed in our plan sets out how that will roll out from the very, very top of the organisation to each and every member right across every region, every division and every district. We will establish community policing teams in each district across the country. And that district, that team will comprise of all of the various different services that we provide, from the overt uniform presence to a plainclothes support staff in terms of the prevention and detection of crime and the protection of life and property. Each district will be divided into what we call a community policing area, and there will be particular ownership given to each of those community policing teams, and they will both be responsible and accountable for delivery of policing in those particular areas, with a particular objective to prevent crime, to detect crime where it does happen, but above all to provide a reassurance to local communities. Working in partnership with these communities, because it is not about An Garda Síochána, it is about a group of people working together to provide that reassurance and that protection to the community, we will establish a community policing fora in each district, a partnership between the teams that I've just mentioned and the local community, both business and residential. These teams will have a direct role in the provision of local policing in local communities. I think Assistant Commissioner Nolan can take us through a number of examples as to how we do that. But community policing is something that we're very familiar with in this country. It's something that we're very proud of, and it's something that we want to build on and go from strength to strength into the future.
Chairperson, thank you very much. What Deputy Commissioner Toomey has said is exactly the way we are progressing. But at this current point in time, we have a significant collaborative engagement process with our joint police committees and all 31 joint police committees across the nation. They are a service by An Garda Síochána at its regular meetings, and indeed at a regional level. I attend the Dublin Joint Police Committee myself. Superintendents and chief superintendents attend divisional committee meetings, and indeed multiple committee meetings. The Garda National Community Relations Bureau has a dedicated office that services the Joint Police Committees by way of advice to members of An Garda Síochána, and indeed getting the reports in from all Joint Police Committees. Indeed, in Dublin City, there is, as I said, the Dublin City Joint Police Committee. There are also high-level group meetings with Dublin City Council and relevant stakeholders, Dublin City Business Forums, the Assertive Case Management Team in Dublin City. There are a significant programme of engagement at all levels, and particularly the TAG programme with teenagers and the late night leagues with young people. But supporting all of this is the Garda Operation, Operation Tor, which is also a significant crime prevention initiative where there are focused, targeted operations that both give crime prevention advice, deliver practical operational experiences, and indeed engage with the community on a regular basis. Indeed, I can go on into any other aspect of that you wish to raise.
I'm particularly interested in what you said about specialist resources and how you make the community policing ethos, to use your word, relevant to those specialist parts of the organisation that are perhaps less visible to the public. So could you tell us something about that?
If we give a very specific example, I suppose one of the issues that causes a lot of harm to communities is in terms of drugs and the sale and supply of drugs. We work very closely, and as both my colleagues have said, it's very much a partnership approach. But last year, in order to deal with that very issue, we merged our Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau. And in March 2015, those units merged. So just to give an example in terms of actually protecting communities, and when the people in the Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau every day go about their business, and indeed all of our units, let that be our roads policing units, let that be our, I'll call them our invisible units, so the people that are out there working every single day in a very covert way, they fully understand that their job is to make sure that they protect all aspects of the community. But last year, since the merger of the Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau, right up to date, there's been over €36 million worth of drugs taken off the streets. And that includes heroin, cocaine, ecstasy, and indeed cannabis. Also, there have been a number of firearms. So to date, since March of last year, there have been 36 firearms seized, including AK-47s, Magorov pistols, significant quantities of ammunition, and indeed some explosive materials as well. So I think the very purpose of the amalgamation of those units was to protect the community from the harm that both these drugs and these types of firearms can cause. In doing that, the Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau have arrested over 200 people. And those arrests have very significant impact in a positive way on communities, because communities can see that. We also work very closely under the National Drug Strategy with other partner agencies to reduce the harmful effects of drugs. So working across a number of agencies. But to make sure that everybody is very focused on that, everybody in An Garda Síochána understands that their job is there to serve the community, no matter what their function is. Even some of our support functions, so for example, our civilian people in our Garda Information Services Centre in Castlebar, they understand that in answering the phone, that every single encounter makes a difference. And that's something that we have put in as part of our philosophy, that every contact leaves a trace. And that trace is either good or that trace is bad. But there's a responsibility on every one of us, as Deputy Commissioner Toomey has said, from the top of the organisation right down to the most junior person. And we inculcate that into our new recruits who are now coming through Templemore, into our reserve members and into our civilian staff. And certainly in all of our promotion courses and in all of our opportunities to be out there publicly engaging, we let the public know that this is a very important part. And that's why the feedback from the public is so important to us. And I might ask Mr. Singh if he would like to give an overview of what would be helpful to the authority in terms of what we have found.
Sorry, Commissioner, in terms of the...
The public confidence.
Oh, the public confidence. In terms of, well, in terms of the levels of trust, as the Commissioner says, we have about an 85% trust level, medium to high trust level. in terms of our satisfaction, we have a very good satisfaction measure, around 70%. In terms of the specific question that you raised in terms of the fear of crime and how we're going to actually measure the fear of crime, we're going to use the attitude survey. Again, this is our continual survey that we've got running in the field. We introduced a suite of questions in quarter one, which we're going to run through the course of this year. Three interrelated questions. The first question is basically asking people about their worry of crime. So are they worried about becoming a victim of crime, about themselves or someone close to them? The issue about the worry of crime is that it doesn't necessarily always pick up the strength or the depth of the fear. So we're running a second question as well. So the second question will be a strength question. So basically we ask, you know, to what extent do you worry about crime in general? So we have worry of crime and then the extent. But crime can also then impact on people's behavior. And what we want to do is to actually make sure that crime doesn't actually affect people's quality of life. So we're going to run a third question as well. So we measure, we ask how much has the fear of crime affected your quality of life? So three sets of questions to measure people's concerns, fear of crime, and their impact on their life. So we started running that in quarter one. The results shall be available quite shortly, soon. Another issue I think that's worthwhile considering, it's one that we might look at, and it's one that we should very much actually look at, is that we know that there are certain groups who probably have a higher fear of crime than others, and some vulnerable groups that you were kind of alluding to. So, for example, we know that minority ethnic groups from previous research who have been victim of racist attacks have actually very high levels of fear of crime. Now our attitude survey is a general survey of the public, so to pick up minority ethnic groups in that's going to be difficult. So we're looking at options to develop a booster survey to look at minority ethnic groups.
And that survey will be published in the near future?
Yeah.
Okay. There's just one final question from me before I hand over to Bob, my colleague. And it's really in relation to the issue you mentioned there about bespoke responses for bespoke groups, because when you talk about a framework, it can actually restrict local initiatives and solutions for local problems. So can I ask you, Commissioner, just how you will balance local initiatives, local solutions coming from the community against a framework that is set from perhaps Garda headquarters?
Absolutely. It's very important. One thing that the inspectors have pointed out to us in several of their reports is the need for standardisation and consistency. But in delivering standardisation and consistency across the principles of policing, you must also make sure that you keep the responsiveness to local needs. The community safety fora that the Deputy Commissioner has highlighted here are very important, but also is collaboration with the community. And particularly right across rural Ireland, the district officer, the local superintendent, plays a very, very big part in understanding what the needs of the local community are. The joint policing committees, but more importantly, the local policing fora play a huge role in that. Our people, our superintendents, our chief superintendents, listen very closely to the communities. They get a lot of feedback, not just from the community members themselves, but also from the other agencies. So we'd work very collaboratively right across. The way we see it going, particularly across rural Ireland, you will have seen recently the fear of rural crime. It was a very, very palpable thing recently. Some of the operations that we put into place were actually national operations, but with a local responsiveness. So the feedback from right around the country locally, they were coordinated nationally, but the local initiatives were very, very important. And some of the benefits of that anti-crime initiative, Operation Thor, was such that we saw local district officers, local superintendents, been able to put into place local solutions to their problems, but consistent with our national priorities and the national principles, and that has worked very, very well. I would also like to say, in terms of, you know, we mentioned about the fear, making sure it's national. Sometimes there's the disruptive activity that is right around the country that prevents crime from happening in the first place. because as you will have seen in our strategy, crime prevention, and again it was something that was highlighted by the Garda Inspectorate, is a number one priority for an Garda Síochána. Preventing crime from happening in the first place, but when it does, making sure that it's been investigated properly. In preventing crime from happening, there is the visible patrols that everybody sees out there, but there's also a lot of invisible policing that goes on the covert side of the business. And that makes sure that actually people, crime is prevented from happening in the first place, that individuals are kept safe, and most importantly, that communities are kept safe. And that's something that we haven't always in the past spoken about very openly, but that is happening. So sometimes in the community you would hear people saying, I don't see the guards around, but actually the guards are there, very much there, and very much present in the community. And it's having that blended approach of high visibility policing, which people have come to think about as the policeman, man and woman in the high visibility jackets. But actually there's a lot of other things that makes that type of policing possible that goes on every single day, day in and day out. And my colleague, Assistant Commissioner O'Mahony, can speak more to that if you wish.
That looks like a segue into the second objective around visibility. But before I hand over to Bob Collins, could I just go back briefly to the community policing teams that Deputy Toomey referred to? Did I understand you to say that they are going to be put in place? And have you kind of a broad indicative timeline for them for that? We're not going to pin you to the wall on it. Just roughly, are we talking about?
We will start implementing them incrementally over the course of 2016. I suppose we have a community policing model currently in place, and there are various different initiatives and programs run across the entire country. And the model is sufficiently flexible to address for rural, urban, larger urban centre. And currently, Assistant Commissioner Nolan is actually doing an evaluation of a number of those projects to take the key learning from them to ensure, going back to the key point that everyone talks about, is they're very happy with the policing that is done, but they would like a consistency. So with that objective in mind, the first stage of this, and it's ongoing as we speak, is to do an evaluation of the projects that are currently up and running. So over the course of 2016, taking the learning from those, we will begin to incrementally implement the community policing teams across the country.
Okay, thank you. And you might share those evaluations with us as they're completed. It would be very helpful to our consideration of the policing plan for next year. Thank you. Bob.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioner, I wonder if I could ask you to focus on the reference to the joint policing committees and the local policing fora in terms of how the Garda Síochána engagement with them can deliver the targeted outcome of improving public satisfaction and reducing the fear of crime. What's your expectation of that, and what would be the index of success in relation to that from your perspective?
Yes, the Joint Police Committees and the Local Policing Fora play a very important role, but as I say, equally important is the local collaboration with the community, because actually engaging with the community at every level, not just through the structure of the JPCs and the Local Policing Fora, informs us of what the local policing needs of an area are. And our superintendents and chief superintendents play a vital role in that, as do our members right across the organisation. And I might get Assistant Commissioner Nolan, because as you know, heretofore the community joint policing committees, the guidelines were prepared by the Department of Justice. They were coordinated by community relations section. In the future, I know the authority will prepare the guidelines for that, and we're very happy to give our findings in relation to the structures and how those joint policing committees have worked. So I might ask Assistant Commissioner Nolan and then maybe Mr. Singh to speak about the measurements.
Thank you, Commissioner. Chair, as I have already said, an Garda Síochána engages on a monthly basis with the joint police committees, and at those committee meetings, an Garda Síochána reports on the rate of crime in the area, the detection rate, particular problems such as public order, such as fear of crime, or such as worry of crime. And indeed, as the Commissioner has said, and as the Deputy Commissioner has said, our community policing approach is flexible enough to cater for both the large city areas, the smaller city areas, and indeed the rural areas. And there are examples of that across the country. In Dublin North Central, there's a very detailed and coordinated small area policing approach. In Kilkenny City, there's a sectoral policing approach. In Tipperary, there's a rural approach that's called Know Your Patch. And indeed, in Limerick and Cork and other areas like that around Ireland, there are different policing approaches. But the key thing about it is that crime in the area and problems in the area are tackled. Garda Síochána is held to account by the local authorities and by the representatives on the joint police committees at those particular fora. And indeed, there can be quite robust exchanges. All of the outcomes of those committees are reported on in local media, and indeed there are many examples of excellent work that's done, and there are many examples of questions being posed to Garda Síochána. I would like to emphasise that the Operation Tor is a visible manifestation of tackling local problems, and indeed there are many other local initiatives beneath that that are conducted to target those people who are causing harm and those people who are committing crime in particular areas. And indeed, I think it's one of the greatest crime prevention initiatives is when local communities can see those who cause harm being tackled on a local level and brought to justice in a local area.
And just in terms of the measurements.
Sorry, I beg your pardon, Gertrude. You need to speak a little bit closer to the microphone. I'm
sorry.
Finding it difficult. Thank you.
Just in terms of the measurements, again, we'll be using the attitude survey again. What we're going to do is we're adding in two new questions, which again will be running on a continual basis. The first question looks at respondents' perceptions about whether there's regular patrols in their area. And the second question is respondents' views on whether they feel that the police presence in their area is right. And so there's a slight distinction there, patrols and police presence, because as commissioners kind of alluded and others have alluded, the presence, a policing presence in any local area isn't necessarily just about the patrolling.
Thank you for that. I think it was notable that in the Garda Inspectorate report, referring to the summary of the experience of attending some joint policing committees, there was general appreciation of the work of Community Gardaí, and one finds testaments to that in the areas in which people live individually. And I think the focus was on the issue was the particular contribution that the fora and the JPCs can make to this. But moving on, because we have time constraints, the identification of collaborative partnerships, and in particular the focus on those who are hard to reach. I just wonder what your sense of hard to reach people is, whether that's a characteristic of the people or whether it's a reflection of the fact, and this is not just in the context of the Gardaí, but that there may be a range of people that we don't try hard enough to reach in all areas of life. And is that the sense in which you approach this particular initiative that you've identified in the plan?
The initiative that we've identified in the plan, and certainly in our modernisation and renewal programme, as you know, we have, and Assistant Commissioner Nolan has referred to it, our Garda Racial, Intercultural and Diversity Office was specifically established in terms of reaching into hard-to-reach minority communities. We also have 270 ethnic liaison officers who operate right across the country. And they will be very engaged with communities who can sometimes be marginalised or be in the minority. And we have very good examples of how that is working in practice, and certainly has built a lot of bridges with communities. In our new plan, what we have is a diversity and inclusion strategy, which is actually looking at expanding on that and making sure that those relationships go from strength to strength. And it is about trust and confidence in Garda Síochána. We are very conscious that we have people who come to this country, and indeed people who live in this country, who haven't always had trust and confidence in Garda Síochána. And as part of our attitude survey as well, we are looking at ways of actually measuring that engagement and measuring how we engage with harder to reach communities. But certainly the evidence that we have so far is that people are engaging. The people are engaging very constructively. It's helping very much to build trust and confidence, and also in empowering people to come forward and report crimes. that heretofore they may not have reported. So that's something that we're very focused on continuing on. I think the levels of trust and confidence in Garda Síochána that Mr. Singh has referred to, that is very much a testament to the work being done by the women and men of Garda Síochána every single day, and as you have said, in communities all over the country, and making sure that no matter where people are, and sometimes we often, you would hear from our own people, that even in some built-up urban areas, as well as in rural areas, you have people who can feel very alone, very frightened, and very marginalised in several ways. And it's our job and our responsibility to make sure that we get out there. We're also very cognizant as well of the need to engage with victims, because some of the reports have said that victims haven't always had the experience that they would like to have had with Garda Síochána. And that while Garda Síochána initially were very, very positive in their engagement, they didn't always felt it was followed through. So during the course of last year, we set up 28 victim service offices right around the country, one in every Garda division. Again, it's something that we are measuring very closely in our public attitude survey, is the experience of victims. But certainly the indications are that those victim service offices are creating a lot of reassurance with victims of crime, and particularly in making sure that their needs and their rights indeed are met.
Thank you. Can I move on to the next, the 3.2 in the policing plan, promoting high visibility policing, and ask you to reflect for us on the question of the closure of a range of Garda stations. One can clearly identify the decision to have a number of station closures as being a rational expression of a plan for the estate generally and for the deployment of resources. But would it be unfair to say, or fair to say, that there isn't as evident a strategy for the alternative, for the compensatory mechanisms to have a Garda presence in those areas where there was a physical presence?
I suppose the Garda stations is one aspect of Garda presence and Garda visibility, and actually our focus is very much more on engaging with the community as opposed to bricks and mortar. And certainly in areas where the Garda stations have closed, we've made sure that it is compensated for by a higher visible presence. Certainly the investment recently in our fleet and making sure that people have appropriate and adequate transport to be able to reach out and into communities. But also we have put in place Garda clinics, and I can have Deputy Commissioner O'Coulon speak to that. In places, and particularly in rural Ireland, where Garda stations have closed, we have alternative methods of engaging with the community. So I think it's really interesting that actually what we are doing is making sure that our people are out engaged with the community in a constructive and partnership way, as opposed to been sitting behind desks and waiting for people to come to the station. It's more about proactive community engagement. And if you wish, Deputy Commissioner O'Coulon can give some examples of some of the alternative strategies we have in place.
Yes, indeed. Well, in developing a strategy around where some of these stations were being closed, we did focus on ensuring that we had better mobile patrols in a planned way for those areas. And that has happened in large areas of rural Ireland, say, where I had charge of the Western region, for example, where we had some stations closing in all of the counties in that region, and where in many instances there were stations very close by, within maybe 3 miles of the one that closed. However, we did in every instance ensure that in order to allay the local people's fears of having a proper service delivered, that we did put alternative patrol patterns in place to ensure that as people came on duty, that they were to ensure that they included all of the sub-districts of that district in their patrol for a given tour of duty. Also in the transition, and some of these were used more than others, we had a series of clinics that were held that were well, I suppose, advertised in local media, where you'd have a Garda or two visit some of these villages and set up in a local hall or whatever for a number of hours per day to give whatever service was required, let it be signing the passport forms or whatever. Again, some of those were more in demand than others. Many people found it just as convenient to go to the nearest Garda station, which would probably be 3 miles in the other direction. So by and large, there was a fairly trouble-free transition in many of those areas where a station closed, in my experience of policing the Western region.
And related to that, would you say something about what, if any, partnership or engagements there may be between the Garda Síochána and other public or non-state agencies who may similarly have reduced their presence, particularly in parts of rural Ireland, whether it's post offices or banks or so on? Are there other ways of working together to sustain a presence that mightn't otherwise be possible?
Well, of course, we've already spoken about the joint policing committees and the local authority input. I think that's crucial to every aspect of rural Ireland, not just in the towns and the cities, because the local authority tentacles go right into the rural environment as well. And it's at that particular forum where we were able to develop, with the assistance of the local authorities, having that presence in some of their offices. And while obviously the banking and post offices are a separate issue, we would at times have shared premises with, say, a post office as well in doing our clinics, yes.
I'd like to move on to another aspect of the visibility question, if I may, and that is sometimes visibility is a function of self-recognition, the extent to which people see themselves reflected in the Garda Síochána in this context. And I wonder, Commissioner, if you would have a view about the extent to which you are satisfied with the present composition of the Garda Síochána. Is 25% women, for example, satisfactory? It's obviously significant that the Commissioner is a woman. But is that, what is your ideal? What do you think would be the desirable? It was interesting also, for example, in the context of the PSNI, the 50-50 recruitment. The tipping point in relation to that was when Roman Catholics achieved a 30% presence. Is that a figure, or would you like to see it as being more substantial?
I think it's very important for us to make sure that our diversity reflects society as it is today. And we have almost 26% of women. You may have seen in our most recent recruitment campaign, we were very focused on ensuring that our campaign reached out to people from all communities, and very focused particularly on recruiting more women, but also recruiting people from very diverse backgrounds, and to make sure that, as I said earlier, that people have the trust and confidence. Our Garda Reserve has been very helpful in that. It has encouraged people from a variety of communities to come forward. And on the careers portal, we were very careful in the way that we framed it, working very closely, of course, with the Public Appointment Service to make sure that we encourage people, for example, from the LGBTI community, from various communities, right across the whole plethora, because our focus and our objective is to make sure that we are representative of the society which we serve. And that in itself helps promote trust and confidence, that people can feel confident to come forward to on Garda Síochána. And likewise, we are focused in the same way on our new reserve recruitment as well. So people that want to come to join on Garda Síochána can see if it's a career that will suit them and can see if it meets their expectations and their needs.
And in terms of achieving that and seeing the implementation of that over time, do you have step-by-step targets that you would like to reach? Do you have, in addition to what you've identified, programs for encouraging groups who are at present underrepresented, including all of the above, as it were? And is there also a sense in which there are questions of geography and, not to put a tooth in it, class, that need to be addressed in terms of the representation of the entire community?
I think we've been very, very fortunate all over the years, and it's no different in the last recruitment campaign. In our last recruitment campaign, we had almost 24,000 applicants. They're very representative of society. There has been no distinction made. We see people from all walks of life, from various backgrounds, as has always been the case in Garda Síochána. I suppose we're very fortunate that we are of the community, we are from the community, and we live within the community. and we would certainly like to see that continuing into the future. Our most recent recruitment campaign has seen almost 17,000 applicants, and again, that's replicated. There are people from every walk of life, and we will see, we're working very closely with the Public Appointment Service, but the early indications are that actually, yes, we do have people from a lot of diverse backgrounds coming forward, but it's not something that we've ever experienced that there's any particular divide. We are representative of society. Of course, as society changes, we want to be continue to be representative of society. But one of our core and our founding ethos is that we are of the community, we live in the community, and that will certainly very much continue.
And as a final question for me before handing back to Judith, are you satisfied or are you confident that that broad policy position that you articulate on behalf of the Garda Síochána would be replicated in every station, and that every station would be a comfortable place for somebody from an underrepresented background at the moment?
Yes, we're in the final stages of our own internal diversity strategy, which actually makes sure that we are again representative, very focused on inclusivity, making sure that people, that there is a proactive inclusivity policy right across the organisation. You know, we've made it very, very clear from the outset that actually it has to be a safe environment. We want to create a safe environment where everybody can feel comfortable and confident to work. As part of our workforce plan and HR strategy, we want to make sure that every individual can achieve their maximum potential. So that's something that certainly you will see it in our diversity and inclusivity strategy, that it is there, it's designed to make sure that that absolutely happens. And I'm certainly not aware of any Garda station in the country which will be any different. We also recruit centrally, so that's very important. We don't recruit locally, we recruit centrally. And our recruitment is done under the auspices of the Public Appointment Service. And as I say, we are working very, very closely to make sure that we are and continue to be representative of the society we serve.
I know that Maureen Lynott wanted to ask a brief question before you pass back to Judith.
It's in the arena of the trust and satisfaction.
You need to get close to the microphone, Maureen.
Is that okay now?
Yeah.
Okay, it's in the arena of the trust and public trust and satisfaction results, which are very positive, and you're to be commended on it. And it's certainly a high level of confidence rather than a very mixed one. But of course, there will be some areas, some groups, some where that is not the case. So could you tell us what was the lowest in your work, Gertjan, and what do you do about it now that you know that?
So there were some variations by satisfaction. There were some variations by levels of satisfaction. I won't rattle off the numbers, but I'll give you the general pattern of it. So in terms of gender, there was actually a gender variation. Women actually had slightly higher levels of satisfaction with the service provided. Satisfaction increases with age as well. So younger groups actually had the lowest level of satisfaction, and as age increases, it gets very positive. There was no clear trend by social class, so there were some variations by social classes, but you couldn't actually say there was a trend there as well. Nationality, their levels of satisfaction were the same. Now, a really important thing to note here is when we say that levels of satisfaction, in each case, the majority of the people were still saying that they were satisfied with the service provided. In none of these groups did we actually see, even let's say younger population, did we actually see people actually saying that the majority were saying that they were dissatisfied with the service. So while we're saying that there's variations in satisfaction levels, the majority of the people are satisfied. It's just the extent of the that.
Did you do it by geographic area?
Pardon me?
Did you carry out the survey by geographic area?
Yeah, so there was also some kind of differences by geographical areas. Urban and rural areas had kind of relatively higher levels of satisfaction than respondents from city areas. So that was probably kind of the key kind of difference there.
Yeah, I'm not going to ask for the specific areas that there was lowest satisfaction. I mean, I'm not asking who you know which they were, but where you know that now compared to other areas, what is the strategy?
Maybe if I can take that, Maureen. There's a clear action plan developed based on the findings. from the public attitude surveys. So the learnings, and particularly in the areas where we need to have a more targeted, focused policing plan to address any areas of development, they're built in locally. So all of the learnings are taken, and where there needs to be corrective action taken, that's done locally by the district and divisional officers.
Thank you.
Thank you. Judith.
Okay, I just wanted to ask one further question in this area before I move on to antisocial behaviour, and that is really tying up the maybe loose ends of what we've been discussing around how the diversity strategy links to the community policing strategy. You could be forgiven perhaps for thinking there's a lot of strategies going on, but how do they actually become relevant to the officer, the man and woman on the ground, and how do they actually live out these strategies without becoming confused by the wide range and the variety of strategies? And I applaud the fact that you're redrafting your diversity strategy, but it is really important that it becomes real on the ground and links to your community policing framework and everything else that you do.
Chair, one of the key elements of the diversity strategy, the diversity and inclusion strategy, is that it's based on recognising difference, acknowledging that there are differences in society, and respecting that difference. And the document, while it's always a document, is being constructed in a fashion that makes it easy to understand for everybody, building on those three basic pillars. That once you recognise, acknowledge and respect difference, there is a good chance that your actions then will be a manifestation of that respect and recognition. And that's the key thing. The principal idea behind the diversity strategy, which is the latest iteration of a diversity strategy in An Garda Síochána, is to make sure that every member of An Garda Síochána, whether they're wearing a uniform or in the plainclothes side of the organisation, understands that there are significant differences in society and that Ireland as a country has changed dramatically in the last number of years, and we as an organisation must be in a position to respond to that difference with a different approach.
Thank you. Could we move on then to antisocial behaviour?
Yes, please do.
I'm interested in the target you have set yourselves around reductions in public disorder and antisocial behaviour. And I would like to hear about how you consistently record and capture an accurate picture of antisocial behaviour in communities, because we know, certainly I know from my own professional policing experience, that while it might seem in the continuum of offending a minor issue, it has a huge impact on community confidence. And if antisocial behaviour isn't dealt with well, then members of the community will think, well, what's the point in reporting more serious things because they don't deal with this well. So it's a big community confidence issue. So I'd like to hear about your plans to consistently define and record antisocial behaviour so that you can work to reduce it going forward.
Again, I might ask my colleague, Deputy Commissioner Toomey, and indeed Assistant Commissioner Nolan. Antisocial behaviour, as you're aware, is a very difficult thing to define, because what's antisocial to one person and indeed to one community may not be to another. We work very, very closely, for example, with the local authorities, again with local communities, in terms of creating a shared understanding of what the issues are in particular communities and understanding what are the problems in that community. And we have a number of different strategies in play. And when I use the word strategies, I don't mean these are all, it's all part of our policing plan. So they're not all individual strategies. And I wouldn't like to give the impression that they are. When we talk about strategies, we're talking about operational strategies and mechanisms to do things. And certainly the collaboration and partnership is really important in dealing with antisocial behaviour. Everything from our schools programmes to our youth diversion programmes to our engagement with local authorities, which is very, very constructive. And I can either Assistant Commissioner or Deputy Commissioner Toomey or Assistant Commissioner Nolan can speak to some of the very specifics that we have in place.
Thank you, Chair. How we deal with antisocial behaviour is set down in legislation, and that sets out the area of what antisocial behaviour covers. And to date this year, we've had 161 antisocial behaviour orders have been issued. We have targeted policing operations that will roll out at various different times of the year. And you will see that under our 2016 policing plan, the consumption of alcohol in public places is one key initiative. Now, we're aware from the analysis that's done that becomes a bigger problem over the course of the summer months. So from here on in, there will be a series of detailed policing plans that will roll out right across the entire country. They will be targeted, they will be local, and they'll be based on the knowledge and experience of the local people. It will be seaside areas. We know in the summer months they will be a greater challenge for us. We know that over the winter months then, that problem recedes and other challenges will come in. I'll hand over now to Assistant Commissioner Nolan, who will deal with in more detail and other issues.
Thank you, Deputy. Chair, I suppose it's important to say that An Garda Síochána has a national juvenile liaison office that administers the juvenile liaison programme for the last 50 plus years. And it's also important to state that juvenile offending has been reducing for a number of years. It's probably flattening out at this point in time, in the early part of 2016. And that programme is also supplemented by the youth diversion programme and the special projects, of which there are now 110 across the country, which ensure that young people who are on the juvenile diversion programme can be engaged in productive activities that help create a better type of a citizen. That is also supplemented by the schools programme that Deputy Toomey has mentioned, which is aimed at both national school level and at secondary school level. And all schools, by and large, get visits from members of An Garda Síochána in the course of the year. Those programmes are very carefully constructed about personal safety, about all kinds of activities related to road safety. We run the in conjunction with the Road Safety Authority, It Won't Happen to Me programme to help socialise people into better roads behaviour. There's also programmes about online bullying and safety online, etc. And again, outside of all of that, there are very specific programmes such as teenagers and Gardaí who engage in a programme of awareness about what it is to be a member of An Garda Síochána, role reversal, etc. That's supported then by the late night league soccer tournaments that go on every weekend all across the country. And again, as what Deputy Toomey mentioned about underage drinking in the summer, there's an operation called Operation Irene, which is focused on preventing and reducing underage drinking. So as you can see, there is a large and a huge plethora of initiatives aimed at keeping young people out of contact with the criminal justice system. And as the numbers are declining, it looks as if it's in a pretty positive trajectory at this point in time.
Okay. Yeah, thank you for that. And it is very clear that there is a lot of excellent work going on with community groups around antisocial behaviour, but I wouldn't want for 1 minute to suggest that all antisocial behaviour involves young people. I'm hearing the Northern Ireland Children's Commissioner in my ear reminding me that not all your antisocial behaviour is the responsibility of young people. So I was struck by what Gertrude was saying about young people's experience of engagement with An Garda Síochána, which sometimes can be more on the negative side than the positive. So in policing antisocial behaviour and in engagement with young people, how can you make sure that that engagement is more positive than negative?
That the relationship with young people is more positive than negative. I think it's our experience that it is very positive. We, again, going back on what Assistant Commissioner Nolan has said, the schools programme gives us a very unique opportunity to actually be able to get our people into schools. And I absolutely agree, by the way, antisocial behaviour, I wouldn't like to give anybody the impression, is only caused by young people. And certainly our experience coming into the summer months is that public disorder caused by drinking in public places isn't young people alone. And indeed, sometimes you're very surprised at the ages of the various people. Yeah. But the reality is that in order to engage with young people, we very much put a lot of emphasis on our schools programme, on our regular engagement. I think one of the defining features of An Garda Síochána, and I mentioned our community presence. So we have members of An Garda Síochána, both serving and retired, who engage with the community in a whole variety of ways, which is very unique and a very defining feature, I think, of Irish society. You know, we have members of An Garda Síochána who, for example, through sporting activities, who through music, who through a variety of different mechanisms actually engage with the community at all levels. But we have members in their own time who actually take young people, for example, to football matches, who train football teams, who train people in a variety of sports and recreational activities. And that serves in no end, and it's very difficult to quantify because they're doing it in a private capacity, but a member of an Garda Síochána is recognised as a member of an Garda Síochána the length and breadth of the country. And let that be when some of our own younger people go home to their local areas and they engage with the community in their local home places, bringing them on, mentoring and coaching teams, that pays huge dividends in terms of trust and confidence in policing. And also then in a more structured way through our schools programme to all of the various activities that we do, the late night leagues that Jack has outlined, but also just the day-to-day engagement in the community. And I think if you go around any community across the country, what you'll see is members of an Garda Síochána engaging with young people, with not so young people, and particularly with people, elderly people. And I was very taken recently with Ear to the Ground, where it depicted, it showed a female member of an Garda Síochána actually going into the daycare centre and going in and imparting crime prevention advice, but also engaging in a very human way with members, elderly members of the community. And I think that goes a long way to actually encourage trust in an Garda Síochána.
If I may just also add that, I said there was a gradation of age, but I also noted that within each group, the majority of respondents still had satisfaction. So for those who are aged 18 and 24, we were talking about 64% who were actually satisfied with the service provided. So
that's it's more than a third who were not satisfied.
So. Yeah, but it's still it's still quite high in terms of it's not a majority are not dissatisfied. So we have 64% satisfaction, and it does climb with age, but still at an 18 to 24 year old.
Could I move on then finally to the area of drinking and illegal consumption of alcohol and disorder caused by excessive alcohol consumption? And I just want to ask about the range of partnerships that have been developed around reducing public disorder as a result of alcohol consumption and relationships with licensed premises, etc., because many of them have these reduced happy hours, etc., and then people are churned out into the street and the guards have to deal with the consequences. So I just wanted to hear about some of your partnership initiatives around the vertical drinking culture, how that's encouraged sometimes and how you have to deal with the consequences of that.
There is no doubt about it. There is a correlation between improvements in the nighttime economy in particular and the whole experience. And again, I might get Deputy Commissioner Toomey to speak about some of the specific initiatives that we have in place. But we do have regular meetings with, for example, the Licensed Drinkers Association and other bodies who have a responsibility in that area. And I have to say they do take their responsibilities seriously. Get Deputy Commissioner Toomey to talk about some of the very specific initiatives we have.
Putting the power and the responsibility into communities for the standard of policing and the quality of life is central to how we go about it. If we take some of the major operations that are run over the course of the year, as part of the planning process, the residential community will be part of that process, but also the business community, and in particular the on-trade and the off-trade. So we will set out clear objectives at the outset of what we're trying to achieve, and they will have a role in that. And certainly, over the course of the last couple of years, their role has been, it has improved, it has enhanced in how they go about the role that they play in each of these operations. If we talk about in Dublin City Centre, agreement has been reached with the on-trade and the off-trade as to the opening hours, as to the access and to the controls that they will have in place to restrict the availability of alcohol. Over the course of the summer months in public places, closer to public parks, closer to beaches, again, they will have a responsibility. So it's empowering the business people as well as local residents and making it a partnership approach to ensure everybody wants to go about their daily life, whether they're going to work, whether they're going to various different communities to visit. They all want to do it safely, and everybody has a part to play in that. So it's ensuring that the business people, and in particular in this particular example, that the on-trade, the off-trade, the hotels, all business people involved in this. They have a part to play in it, and it's making them responsible and holding them accountable for that. And we've seen considerable improvements over the last couple of years in each of these segments of society, taking responsibility for the role that they play in it.
Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Judith. Just before Dr. Conway has a question, but would you say that you're happy with the level of engagement from the business community and the level of support that you get? Or is there anything the authority could do to help you in that regard?
I think there's always room for improvement, for sure. But I think in general, we would say that we're very, very happy with the business community and that the role they play. I think over the last number of years, they do see that their role, they do take it seriously, and they really value that relationship. And policing is about relationship, but we've talked about trust and confidence. That's all developed and built on relationships, and relationships are built up over time. And I certainly think that the relationship between An Garda Síochána and the business community, and indeed all other partners that we work with, be it public transport, be it local authority, be it the HSE, I think we have a very, very good relationship with them, and I couldn't certainly say that we don't have a relationship, but for sure there's always a need and an opportunity to improve that over time.
All right, thank you. Vicky Conway has a question.
Hi, yeah, I just wanted to follow up on the Chair, thank you, on that conversation between Judith and Gresham, and on that point of young people and the engagements, and it's great to hear all that evidence of the really great work that is being done to foster good relations. But I do think it's noticeable that as yet efforts haven't been made to measure the impact of those. So under-18s are not included on the attitude survey. Is there any interest in including them so that we can assess the extent to which those efforts are having a positive impact?
That's one we're going to have to explore, because as you're aware, there's some methodological issues about interviewing under-18s. So it is one that we can and will be kind of considering.
Great, thanks.
Thank you. Before we move on to the next objective, I think it's we should certainly note the very positive data that Gretchen has been sharing with us. And I think we would encourage you, as soon as you think, to put that data in the public domain. It's not so easy to engage with data for the audience and for viewers at home when we're discussing numbers. So we would certainly encourage the publication of your survey work. It's very creditable and very positive, and we'd like you to do that. Before I move on to objective number three, I just want to finish the round of introductions, if I may. On my far left is Pat Costello. From this side, obviously, we've had Vicky Conway, Noel Brett, Valerie Judge, and Moling Ryan. And Valerie is going to lead the discussion in relation to Objective 3, which is around modern communication channels to communicate more closely with the community. So, Valerie, if I could hand over to you.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Commissioner. Yeah, Objective number 3.3. Talks about the objective is set out as the use of modern communication channels to communicate more closely. I think from what we've heard, I think the authority recognises completely that the fundamental communication between An Garda and the public is the interpersonal one-to-one communication. And you mentioned the policy earlier, the strategy of every communication leaves a trace, and I think that's something that everybody recognises as an ongoing positive move. And obviously the formal communications complement that. I'm interested in the initiative that's described against this objective is the implementation of the new Garda Communications Strategy to improve communications with both internal and external audiences, and maybe just stay with external for the moment. I wonder, would it be helpful if you just gave us a sort of a framework of what's in that strategy and how it's going to continually improve the reach into the community? And I'm thinking in particular where you mentioned the hard-to-reach groups or maybe the huge numbers of people who don't actually have day-to-day interaction with the Gardaí.
Yes, our communication strategy is an integral part of our overall modernisation and renewal plan. And indeed, we have a pillar in it which is called Communicating Better on All Fronts. So the strategy, and I'm mindful of the fact if we talk about strategies again, they're not all independent strategies, they're all interrelated and aligned. So basically our first thing is to establish the Office of Corporate Communications. That will very much focus then on, and again I might go back in a moment to talk about some of the specific initiatives, but internal communications, communications with the public, media relations, and also around stakeholder information. So for example, let it be our interaction with the authority, with the Public Accounts Committee, with the Justice and Defence Committee, or whatever our stakeholders are, that there is a data pack, so to speak. The specific initiatives that we are looking at and we've already commenced, we already have a very good, and I'm going to ask Deputy Commissioner O'Coulon to speak about some of the specific initiatives, but we already have a number of very specific initiatives, particularly through social media. But I'm delighted that you identified, because something that we're very careful of in terms of expanding our communications channel is to make sure that they don't replace the human interaction. And, you know, a lot of our initiatives are technologically enabled, but actually what we want to make sure is that the human engagement remains a priority. But I might ask Deputy Commissioner O'Coulon to just speak about some of the specific initiatives that we have in place.
Okay, Commissioner. You've asked for emphasis on the external piece, I suppose, so I'll start with that. And I suppose our emphasis there will be to build on increasing our social media channels, and we've had great success in that area over the past few years. Just to instance a few, our Twitter account has 210,000 followers, and that gives a lot of information in relation to traffic, etc., on a daily basis. And we also were winners of the Public Relations Institute of Ireland Award in relation to the social media, and then also the SOCI's Social Media Award for the best use of social media by state body. So there's a lot of work going on in that space. Mm-hmm. And obviously there are people of a younger generation that are plugged into that, but it's amazing the number of people that actually do plug in and do respond to that particular media outlet. But we have to develop, obviously, others as well. And I'm brought back to an earlier question in relation to the discussion about rural crime and maybe the fear of crime in rural areas, and the success we've had with things like Text Alert. So these are schemes that are set up in local areas by sub-district level, and we have over 700 of these at the moment. And where you have people who sign up to it, who will text, who get crime prevention information across their phones from a local policeman or woman who's on the spot, as it were, and who also get some feedback in relation to maybe movements of criminals, etc., that nature. And that has been a huge success, and there's been a huge demand for that to expand. So we're putting a lot of emphasis on that as well in relation to especially our rural hinterlands where there may be a fear of crime or a perception in those communities where they're not at the centre of things, and where they feel that a service mightn't be immediately available to them, that they get a lot of help and assistance from knowing that they will be told on a regular basis as to any suspicious movements in their areas, and how they can feed back as well into making sure that the local Garda can take action where required. Mm-hmm. So they're just two quick examples of, say, how we hope to improve on getting out to the external audience. Of course, there's a more formal way, and it involves the media. And in that space, obviously, we have a very busy press office, but we believe that it's not just the corporate press office that need to be involved. Every single man and woman in the organisation has a part to play in getting our message out there. Mm-hmm. So they're also in receipt of messages, but in getting messages out to the public, for example, that, you know, they all have a vital part to play. And in that space, since the beginning of the year, we've trained over 100 people right across the country in being able to speak to the media on behalf of Garda Síochána. Agus istoigh go mhiarrtach mar rath chathair le go bainte seo, bhfuil rinnt wa dina, bhfuil gael Jacob plucky freshen, mar chuid gan grúpa sin, fainéil sin, agus go mhéis sé dearbh fáil. Dan de maan hebben ze zelfs eskelge. De fabel niet hier is en nu de fabel gelge niet hier is. Dus de markt haast eigenlijk niet eens schapen of jan niet hier. So they're just a few examples of what work we are doing in that space at the moment to ensure that we get our message out to the public in a very, I suppose, modern way, in some of the ways that are tried and tested, but also using the more traditional media outlets.
Mm-hmm. It's obviously in the nature of social media that it grows organically, and you're not necessarily targeting an audience, but are the analytics that you can probably get, and you don't expect necessarily to get into it today, but do your colleagues maybe use the analytics that you can get behind the Facebook pages and the Twitter pages quite easily these days? Is that helping? And maybe Gershon, do you have a view on any listening that can be done through the social media channels as well as communicating outwards?
It is something that we still have to look at. In terms of the work that we've been doing so far, I think our focus has been looking at the take-up of communications and the take-up of our social media channels. So, again, we do survey people in terms of whether they've actually accessed the channels. So I think about 13% of respondents actually accessed the channel. 80% of them actually found them very useful. So when people do access our channels, they're quite positive. We also look at some of the other communication campaigns as well, and again measure their impact as well. So while we haven't had a look at the analytics, and it is a space that we could go into, we are actually providing some support in this in terms of the take-up and the impact and effectiveness of it.
Okay. And maybe if I could just ask Gertrude another question. Obviously, the attitude survey is very important communication in terms of listening and hearing what people are saying to you. When you referred back earlier to Maureen's question to the levels of satisfaction, were you able to correlate that with the degree of interaction the person had had with the service prior to the survey? And was there a difference between people who had an interaction or not? Because sometimes perception can be, and social media is a case in point, perceptions can spread that don't relate to the truth at all. I'm just wondering what you've picked up.
So the key point of contact is when someone is a victim of crime.
Okay.
So
they've all had interaction.
Yeah, so we'll pick up that at that point. So one of the things that we are going to, and we have to kind of appreciate that the survey is, it's only about a year old, it's in its infancy, that we are actually developing it. So a contact question is one of the things that we're certainly considering, but we do look at satisfaction levels by victimisation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I suppose it might be a difficult one to answer, but again, maybe Assistant or Deputy Commissioner Hulhan, the reach out and the growth of the social media, and maybe just look at the text alert in particular. Do you have targets there in terms of number of people, number of individuals who are involved in text alert? And could you use that in a feedback way as well? My limited understanding is that it's a very useful service in alerting people to something that might be suspicious in their neighbourhood, etc. Can you use that in a way to engage the community in terms of giving information back?
Yeah, well, at the moment we have 794 actually text alert schemes.
Schemes. Do you know how many individuals?
140,000 subscribers.
Okay.
So yes, and of course it'll depend on the community and the size, whether it's rural or urban, or whether it's maybe suburban, the number of people that are involved in those particular schemes. Mm-hmm. But what's important is really is the knowledge and the comfort that people can get from knowing that they're not just on their own, that there's a network of people that will all get that message at the same time. Mm-hmm. And that in reacting to that information, whether it be feeding information back to the local Garda station or maybe calling a neighbour or whatever else they may want to do, that they know that there is support. Yes. And comfort to be got from being involved in that particular. It has been a huge success.
It seems to be very successful. Could I move on just to the area of internal communications then? And we talked about modern use of modern technology, and the authority would be aware that there's to be a significant investment in IT systems, which I'm sure is welcomed by everybody. Are there any specific initiatives that will help the Garda in his or her day-to-day work in actually the actual process of crime detection and crime prevention? I'm just wondering, are there any leaps forward that you can tap into in terms of new technology? Any learning maybe from other jurisdictions in terms of using modern communication methods?
Yeah, well, I think the first thing I'll say, and it was mentioned earlier about the face-to-face and the effectiveness of face-to-face communications, that is obviously equally relevant within internally. And it was one of the things that really informed what we have done around our modernisation agenda. And that we did have those face-to-face meetings, and we did go out to the four corners of this country as part of that consultation phase to get the feedback from the members at the front line as exactly what was hurting them and what they needed. And, you know, there was a fairly strong chorus coming back that, you know, there was a lack of technology there, of course. But again, the message that has to go the other direction is like there's a finite resource. We have to manage that as well. Mm-hmm. And we then have to prioritise how we spend that resource that we get in order to reach the biggest number of people we can by whatever spend we make. And that's the space we've been in over the past 12 months in doing that prioritisation piece. And there's lots in there that will give great comfort to the people at the front line. It'll be from contact management, our CAD system that's been developed, our exhibit management system and property. All of those things are being rolled out at different stages of development at this particular time. But we have to manage expectations as well, of course, because, you know, these things don't happen overnight. Some of them are very complex ICT projects that will take a number of years in some instances to deliver, even with full resource backing. There's a procurement process to be put in place. There are training elements that have to be attended to. And all of that will take a planned approach. But that's the space we're in. We have people that will be given the task of getting that message to the front line, and that will be a constant flow of information. But it's not just in one direction, of course. That has to be a feedback loop as well. Mm-hmm. And it's critical that we get that feedback at different stages of any project to ensure that where we need to tweak things, let it be from a training point of view, for example, if there's insufficient or if it's felt that people aren't getting sufficient training in a particular piece of ICT, that we can tweak it to ensure that we have the capacity there to deal with that. And again, to prioritise, as I say, so we get the greatest reach and the greatest hit rate in relation to getting most of our people in the organisation that they're going to get some lift from that investment.
Okay. I know it's early days in terms of your sort of investment programme in IT, so I suppose we look forward to future meetings to hear about progress in those areas. But thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair. Just to finish on that point, and for my own information, the time span for the IT project is a number of years. Is it set out in your modernization program? Is it 5 years? Have I got that right?
Absolutely. The investment that we have secured for the IT, it takes a period of 5 years. So it's across a period of 5 years. And in our modernization renewal program, as Deputy Commissioner Cullen has pointed out, it's a prioritised program over that 5 years. And maybe just speaking to the question in terms of what's in it for our members, there are a number of things. And on the communications front, better communications, one of the issues is around the intranet, so to speak. So we have an internal portal and some collaboration tools. They've been prioritised. That helps people. But I think the most important aspect of our prioritisation around our technological investment is around professionalising the investigative process. So as was said earlier, all the way from crime scenes, so gathering evidence, major investigations management, and all the way through the investigative process. Again, speaking to a lot of the issues that were identified in the Garda Inspectorate's report, in all 10 reports, but particularly report number 10. So I think, and Deputy Commissioner Cullen had mentioned the particularly the CAD, so the computer aided dispatch, and the deficits that were there. So we very much welcome that, and that's our prioritisation. So certainly at future meetings we'll be able to keep the authority updated on the progress in relation to those initiatives. But they will happen incrementally over time. As we've always said, managing expectations is really important, so we've said it to our own people. It isn't a light switch moment. You don't just switch from something that's probably 20 years behind to all of a sudden making this happen overnight. Could I just maybe mention two things, because I think going back to the question about how do we measure, particularly around the communications piece, I think two really good indicators. The text alert scheme, as you know, is a collaboration with Minchin Natira and across a number of different agencies. But 2 million text alerts, that's a lot of text alerts in terms of community reassurance and take up from the community. We also have our Child Rescue Ireland alert, our cry alert, and that's been used 5 times since its inception. But just to give an indicative amount of the take-up on those initiatives, in one recent cry alert, we had 1.6 million hits on Facebook. That's very big take-up. And in fairness to the people and the members of the public and the community that inputted and engaged in that cry alert, it played an absolutely instrumental part in successfully recovering the child, and again protecting the child and the family.
Thank you. Okay.
Will we move on to the next one? Is that okay? We're going to move on now to objective 3.4, which is to provide a safe environment for road users and to improve road user behaviour in collaboration with partner agencies. And this discussion is going to be led by my colleague, Moling Ryan. Moling, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairperson. Commissioner, you've got three initiatives noted in your policing plan, the heading of road safety, and I hope to touch on each of the three in turn. And if I might, maybe I'll certainly use the backdrop of the recent traffic statistics for that purpose. But the first one is enhancing enforcement and education in pursuit of safer roads. And the headline figure, obviously, from the traffic statistics is that once again there's been a reduction in the number of road deaths from a figure of 193 in 2014 to 166 in 2015, and I know that a lot of parties were involved in that, Road Safety Authority and so on. Are there particular elements or particular initiatives or strategies that you've got in place that has contributed to the reduction? And I'd also be interested in is if you've got particular initiatives or strategies planned for the remainder of 2016.
Okay, thank you. And on this, I might ask my colleagues, Assistant Commissioner O'Mahony and Chief Superintendent Reid, to come in around the specifics. But I think at the outset, it's important to say that the preservation of life is a key priority for Garda Síochána and making sure that we can ensure safe roads for all of our people. A big part of our focus in our modernisation and renewal programme is making sure that we move from just a narrow focus to make sure that we use technology, going back to the previous question, and introduce a roads policing unit to help make our roads even safer, and also at the same time denying criminals the use of the road network. We have a number of very specific strategies in place to make sure that that happens, and I might hand over to my colleague, Assistant Commissioner O'Mahony, who will speak to those.
Good afternoon, everybody. I suppose just to give you a general overview of what has happened so far in 2016 in the area of roads policing. And we have, as of this morning, we've had 50 deaths on the roads, which is, again, it's 50 too many. But as the Commissioner has said at the outset, there has been significant strides made over the last number of years in relation to the road deaths, and I suppose a lot of that is in relation to its enforcement and the importance of enforcement in that area. Again, we're four up this year in relation to this time last year, so very, very conscious of that and very focused in ensuring to bring that down. We have a hope that by 2020 that we will be able to bring down road deaths to an average of probably around 120 a year. That's certainly a focus that we are working towards. Already this year we've detected over 40,000 speeding intercept detections. 2,000 seatbelt detections have been made, and the number of mat checkpoints also a considerable amount of mat checkpoints. Very conscious again of the recent media issues around the breath tests, and we are down on breath testing. We have 67,500 people breath tested in the first quarter of 2016. It's an area that needs to be focused on. While having said that, I suppose a lot of the work that we are doing is at present is in relation to targeted policing in areas. And just to give you a sense of it, 78% of our roads are non-national roads. They're regional roads, and they're the by roads around the country, and that's where most of our detections are, and we're focusing very much on those areas where offences are being committed, and thus I suppose visibility in those areas is important And while the vast majority of people travel obviously on the main highways of the country, and visibility is very, very important there as well, but we have to prioritise in relation to the numbers we have. I think everybody is aware of the decrease in numbers in relation to overall in policing, right across policing, and that's one of the focuses that will be there for the future. And as people come on stream from Templemore, they will be allocated to roads policing as necessary. One of the areas where I certainly intend focusing on in relation to in the interim is the importance of ensuring that roads policing is not just about dedicated traffic police officers. It's about every member of an Garda Síochána right across the organisation, no more than in community policing or no more than any other aspect of policing, that they have responsibility for roads policing and ensure that where offences are being committed or are detected, that they're dealt with in the manner that they should be dealt in. That's very much a focus in relation to that. I suppose one of the areas that I can see in relation to when you look at trends and while detections are down in some areas, and there's no doubt about it, some of the detections are down because of enforcement, but there are other reasons for that, and there are many reasons, and I think there is certainly in some areas you can see that there is more compliance in relation to that. And just to give you one very important example, I think in relation to that, is that while the number of breath tests are down, drivers, the detections for drivers under the influence of alcohol or drugs in the first quarter of 2016 is 1,833, and that compares to 1,765 for the same period last year.
Is there not a concern? Is there not a concern that there might be a possible correlation between the reduction in breath tests and the reduction in the number of detections for driving with excess alcohol?
Yes, I think I'd have to acknowledge that is a possibility, and as I've said, there is also certainly a compliance, and Aidan here beside me has a long experience in relation to dealing with those aspects, and I'll just ask him to give you more specifics in relation to that.
Yes, our roads, our national plan is informed by our roads policing operations plan, which is developed as part of the national plan, and that contains two elements, road safety and roads policing, which is denying criminals the use of the roads. And as the Assistant Commissioner has said, 78% of our roads are rural, and our focus for the first quarter is towards those areas, providing support and reassurance to the communities. And also, that's where the majority of our fatalities and serious injuries are happening. And there's anecdotal evidence that a majority of the fatalities are taking place within 10 to 15 kilometres of people's homes. So providing that high visibility in those rural areas will impact on our figures, but we readjust them as part of our roads policing plan as we target more areas. It's about target enforcement, using less resources, better intelligence-led, and as the Assistant Commissioner has said, our drunk under the influence is up. So our activity levels are constant, and yet there's been a year-on-year reduction because there is compliance. As last week we took part, as part of TISPOL, the European traffic network, we took part with 23 countries in a speed marathon last Thursday morning. Of the 80,423 cars that went through our checkpoints, there was 303 detections. So that's less than 0.5% of people were over the speed threshold. People are listening. We're very focused on our social media, as has been explained by the Commissioner. And for example, with the recent tower campaign, we sent out on social media at Garda Traffic a picture of a bald tire, and there was 80,000 hits on that. So people are watching, people are listening, and that is our focus. It's working with internally with our districts and our divisional resources, and externally. We're informed by the European Commission's 50% reduction in road fatalities by 2020, which should bring us to 124 fatalities a year, 124 too many. Yep. We're also informed by the government's road safety strategy, which is, we're working very closely with the road safety authority, the local authorities, the transport stakeholders. So as we now move into our second quarter, we will focus on those areas which have shown to be deficient.
Moling, sorry, I just want to clarify something before you, if you don't mind. I was very interested in your TISPAL figures.
Yes.
And we're very keen in the authority to get performance benchmarks.
Yes.
So could you tell us how you compared to some of the other countries? The idea of a speed marathon kind of fascinates me. So yes. I take it that meant that it happened at broadly the same time and subject to the same kind of metrics in different countries. So
yes.
How do we do on the league?
Well, it only took place last Thursday into Friday morning. The figures were only coming in over the weekend. We were in the position to get our own, but certainly we have 14 countries in at the moment, and we're well up there in terms of road safety. We're fifth best in Europe at the moment in terms of reduction of fatalities.
Okay.
Unfortunately, Europe is off target, and we need to increase our reductions from 6.2% to 6.8% annually. And Garda Commissioner is very focused on that. As I say, Ireland has the presidency, and we have a huge commitment across Europe.
Well, we'd be happy to hear about, you know, as you get those benchmark, as you get those data in from other forces, we'd be very happy to hear how we feature relative to others as the year goes on. So well done on that. Sorry, Moling.
Certainly I appreciate the objective of seeking to improve driver behaviour. Interesting, I noticed in the traffic statistics that there was a reduction in fixed charge notices for mobile phone use. Does that, in your opinion, reflect improved driver behaviour, or is it an issue of the extent of detection or observation on your part?
Again, it's very difficult to be specific in relation to any one area, but certainly from looking at what we can look at in relation to it, I think that it's probably there's certainly a mixture of both, and certainly there is a concentration, and we've had a number of operations throughout the first quarter of 2016 focused on mobile phone and as well as other areas.
One issue, Commissioner, is the issue of the number of Gardaí assigned to the traffic corps and the impact that has on the capacity of the force or the effectiveness of the corps of the force in both detecting and preventing offences, road offences. I'm aware that there have been over the last few years quite a considerable reduction in that number. Do you have proposals for 2016, or do you have proposals for the years, for the 2017-2018 on that area?
Yes, absolutely. As the Assistant Commissioner has said, roads policing remains a number one priority for us, along with everything else. What we have done is, despite the reduction in the numbers in the traffic corps, as Assistant Commissioner Mahoney has said, we are making a focus on roads policing as a huge part of our community safety. It's making sure that people can use roads safely. So, for example, both our hybrid checkpoints, our Thor checkpoints, are also focused on traffic enforcement. And that's why, even though we've seen a reduction in some of the numbers, we also see an increase in the number of arrests. And that's very much focused on that. As we go forward, one of the things that you will see in our plan, we have a huge emphasis on roads policing. And I think the partnership and collaborative element of that, both with the Road Safety Authority and also with the community themselves. So ensuring that people understand and are aware of the dangers that they pose themselves and other road users. And particularly as we come back into darker nights, on pedestrian behaviour as well, so not just driver behaviour, make sure the roads are safe for everybody to use. One thing that you will see in our revised organisational structure is actually a complete emphasis on roads policing, because it does need to be managed and coordinated nationally with a strategic lead nationally, and then making sure that the numbers that are there. Unfortunately, because of the situation we find ourselves in capacity and capability, it will take time to rebuild those. But our emphasis certainly in our plan going forward is on roads policing and major event management, making sure that the focus is, going back to the earlier question, on community safety being the objective, and making sure that there's a shared understanding of that. So over time, we will see those numbers increasing again, but with an emphasis on roads policing. And I think that's going to be what will be the success barometer.
Second initiative speaks about continuing to implement the recommendations of the Garda Inspector report on the fixed charge processing system. Now, this 2014 report made nearly 40 recommendations, covering a whole range of areas: audits, tracking, summons, serving processes, legislative deficiencies, endorsing penalty points, and so on. What I'd be interested in is if you'd like to share with us particular initiatives, particular areas that you've already made progress on, and if you might identify the particular areas of emphasis for the remainder of this year.
I might ask Chief Superintendent Reid just to go into the specifics, and we can talk you through the specific initiatives that we have implemented.
Yes, 20 recommendations have been implemented, and four of the recommendations are under responsibility within Garda Síochána, and two are shared with the Criminal Justice Working Group. And in relation to the ones which are outstanding are in relation to summonses, scanning equipment for the FCPO, which is the central office in Turles, and the safety camera, the Garda robot vans. So in respect of the scanning equipment, that's an IT solution which is almost at completion stage. The draft fixed charge circular for implementation is with the Garda Professional Standards Unit for finalisation. And again, the summons is work in progress with the court service, and is due for completion at the third quarter of this year.
Okay, thank you. In the short time left to me, there was a final one is in terms of increasing the use of automatic number plate recognition technology for roads policing and as an investigation tool. And you might be good enough to share with us the initiatives and that you propose for 2016 in that particular area. I recognise what you've done, but it might be maybe you might start by just identifying what it actually does and how it actually works before saying what you're actually putting in place.
Absolutely. We can get Deputy Commissioner Operations to give you an overview of what it actually does, and then we can either go through the statistics here, but in the interest of time, it might be better to provide the statistics.
Absolutely.
Because they're quite comprehensive.
Thank you, Chair. On Garda Síochána, use mobile AMPO systems. In other jurisdictions, they can use a fixed AMPO solution. Primarily, the capacity available to Garda Síochána is a mobile AMPO systems in a large number of our traffic cars and other units. We work in partnership with other agencies who have the fixed sites. So while we specifically have the mobile capacity, the fixed capacity is primarily owned by the local authorities and the National Roads Authority, and we access those sites as we need, depending on the demand at any particular time. The plan is to develop and to enhance that facility so that we can use it more proactively. At the moment, we use it as a preventative, as an investigative tool, but the intention is that over the course of 2016 and beyond, we will increase our partnership and we'll use the fixed capacity proactively and also from a crime perspective.
Thank you. Just a couple of follow-ons from myself and if my colleagues, if anybody, Pat, would you like, please?
All right. Okay. Thank you very much. Just in relation to death road prevention and accident black spots. I'm just wondering, so I just presume the answer is yes, but just checking, if you like, for my own interest. Is there a link between all the checkpoints that you have and accident black spots. How are particular locations for checkpoints picked? And if there is a link, then are you satisfied that the targets for the individual Gardaí support that strategy? And finally, are you satisfied that the general public are aware of the accident black spots?
Again, I might just get Deputy Commissioner Toomey to do that, but maybe just to close out on the AMPR question, because I think it's important that there's an overview of what's done, because it relates to that question as well. So just to give an indication, I know I said that the AMPR is very extensive, but it allows us actually to upload a number of hits and then upload a number of vehicle identifications, and then if there are hits in those. So just to give an example, for the first quarter of this year, there were almost 4 million uploads, and out of that, there were 84,707 hits. And again, I know in the time that is here, it's a very complicated a piece of equipment, but actually it's very interesting when you look at how that feeds into road safety, and then how that makes sure that actually by joining the dots, which comes to the question in terms of the accident black spots, that the AMPR equipment can be deployed accordingly in conjunction with the fixed AMPR equipment. And Deputy Commissioner Operations will talk about how we identify the black spots and where the correlation are.
Detailed analysis took place of 5 years of accident data, and we identified in excess of 100 locations, which were the most prone locations for fatal and serious accidents right across the country. We entered into a contract with the Go Safe camera for, and it was a unique partnership between ourselves and an outside provider, and the enforcement is provided by GoSafe cameras, and it's well known, has been running for a number of years, and we're in the process of reviewing that operation. We are aware that there has been a 30% reduction in the number of fatal and serious accidents in these 100 plus locations. So basically what we're saying is that these are the areas where you were most likely to have a fatal or serious accident across the road network of Ireland. And as a consequence of that, the work that has been done over the last number of years, those accidents, those fatal and serious accidents, have reduced by 30%. The locations are purely driven by the accident data and what that information tells us. It has been a very successful operation, and we're certainly satisfied that lives have been saved and serious injuries have been prevented from the work that has been done.
Well done, thank you.
Thanks, Pat. I think that's a very important point, because the public don't necessarily always perceive and understand that there actually is a strategy and there is a selection process involved. And I'm glad we got an opportunity to say that today. I think Noel has a question.
Commissioner, I just want to ask you a little bit around the role of the Traffic Corps in preventing and detecting the trafficking of potentially vulnerable people across the road network, and in particular if you could say a little bit around just your program of checking heavy goods vehicles and how that's working.
The Traffic Corps and the Roads Policing Unit, as they will become known, play a vital role in actually preventing and detecting, but most importantly focused on preventing, because again the objective is about ensuring road safety and road user safety for all road users. And they play a very vital part in doing that. And in order to be able to do that, the AMPR obviously is a tactical tool that we use, which contributes hugely to that. But it continues on. In the future, and as we go forward, it's even going to play a more important role, as we said earlier, even with the combined checkpoints. So to address some of the deficits that we've identified in checkpoints, actually those hybrid checkpoints, as we call them, they become a much more important tool in making sure that we do ensure the road safety. But again, I think as Assistant Commissioner Mahoney said, we can't underemphasise the importance of partnership particularly with the Road Safety Authority, about creating an awareness about how people can use the roads in a safer way, and to be able to make sure that we actually address any issues that arise in collaboration and in partnership.
Thanks, Commissioner. Okay.
Thank you. Before we close, Commissioner, I'd like to ask you about a slightly different but related matter. We've had some very good discussions. The authority has had some very good meetings with you and your team, both today and in February, around the area of gangland crime. And we're here discussing community safety. So is there anything you'd like to take this opportunity to say to the community, from a community safety point of view, about gangland crime?
Well, I think it's very important that first and foremost that there is an absolute realisation that gangland crime, organised crime, and indeed, while it doesn't specifically relate to today's meeting, but that dissident activity and anything that would cause harm to our communities remains number one priority. I mentioned earlier in terms of, you will appreciate that there are live ongoing investigations, merger investigations and other investigations, so we're very constrained in what we can say, other than to say the investigations are progressing very well. Separately than that, I mentioned earlier in terms of our emphasis and the priority that we give to this, one of the priority areas that we, in our new structure, that we prioritised, there were two areas actually. One was around our Protective Services Bureau, so particularly for vulnerable victims of crime, and the second was around our Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau. And I know some of the authority members had an opportunity to visit both of those areas, because in terms of community trust and confidence, they are two very important areas that we must address. Again, as I said at the outset, the communities in where these terrible crimes happened, they in no way support the perpetrators of these crimes. But what we do is we maintain our focus on ensuring that the perpetrators of those crimes are brought to justice. And that remains a priority for us. If I give an example of the last, since the amalgamation of the Drugs and Organised Crime Bureau in March 2015, as I said earlier, there's been over €36 million worth of drugs seized. Including very serious drugs, including heroin, cocaine, ecstasy, cannabis. We have over 200 people arrested, again, all people involved in organised crime and drug trafficking. And we have seen over 36 firearms seized, including AK-47s, Magorov pistols, very significant quantities of ammunition, other types of weaponry. That remains our resolve to continue to fight and to tackle this type of crime. It's not our only priority. Some of the issues that we mentioned here are also of a priority for us, but that will remain and will remain steadfast in that. I think it's also important then to speak about the harm reduction and creating an awareness among the community of the harm that organised crime, and not everybody sees organised crime in the way it manifests itself in murders, in the way it manifests itself in drug dealing, but also in terms of intellectual property crime and, you know, items coming on sale that in some way are feeding back in to what is an organised crime gang and making profits for organised crime. So again, part of our strategy, very focused on creating an awareness around the community in relation to what exactly manifests organised crime and how that can be tackled. I'd also like to mention working very closely in partnership with our colleagues, the Police Service of Northern Ireland, for example. Even in the last number of days, it was over €300,000 of drugs seized. And that's something that we remain steadfastly focused on. So I think it's important in reassuring in terms of community confidence and community trust. It remains our priority, and it will continue to remain our priority. And irrespective of all of the pressures, it remains our number one priority.
Thank you very much for those remarks. Just a little commercial for the moment on part of the Policing Authority. This is our first public event, and I want to thank the Commissioner and her team for coming along and for being so fulsome and engaged across the materials. But I also want to draw our audience attention to the fact that at the moment we have a public consultation underway in relation to a code of ethics for the Gardaí. The documentation is available on the Policing Authority website, but one of my colleagues here, who's sitting up there in the corner, will give you copies if anybody would like to get copies of the consultation document this afternoon. And the closing date for that, for this round of consultation in relation to the Code of Ethics, is the 8th of May. There'll be another opportunity later in the year when we will have a further round of consultation about ethics. The authority will also, I think, be taking forward some of the conversations we've had here today in our committee meetings and in relation to the designing of our work together going forward. And also, indeed, the authority will be developing its own engagement with the chairs of the joint policing committees before the year is out. And community policing will be very much
part of our discussion in that forum. Finally, I would like to thank my own team. First of all, the authority members for the work they put into preparing for today. The team in the organisation who did a lot of work to prepare for what was our first big event. I'd like to thank the communications team here for helping us to keep in touch with each other and also to get our message and our meeting out to the wider world. And with that, can I declare this meeting closed? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.